if you're sitting there and you're contemplating which car you should buy because you are a single gentleman and you want to pick up ladies, perhaps you want a car that looks good, this is not one that you should buy, because I have noticed as we're driving along that it is not the women who are looking at this car. They don't see me, so it's not me that's the issue. But they don't look at the car, it's the older guys who are looking at this because they think it's cool. The ladies, not so much. So if you're thinking to get this car because you wanna be picking up some ladies, I would think maybe not looking at this one. Only because it's the dudes that are retired who are checking this car out as I'm driving along. Now, I know Mopar enthusiasts aren't super thrilled with me after the last video that we did on the 2017 Jeep Grand Cherokee, but I think we're gonna vindicate ourselves today with this. Our spotlight today is on the 2018 Dodge Challenger GT all-wheel drive. Now, before you all boo that this is a V6, keep in mind that this engine has more power than the Challenger from 1972. So we're gonna be showing you everything about this car, taking it for a drive, trying our best to get that all-wheel drive system to kick in with a little bit of snow that we've had over the past couple days, and showing you everything else you need to know if you're in the market for America's muscle car. Now, this generation Dodge Challenger came out in 2008, and this is still the same generation despite it having a facelift. So this is one of the oldest vehicles in Chrysler's lineup currently. But I really do have to give them credit. They take a very original design from the original Challenger back in the 70s, and were able to adapt it in a way that makes it not only modern and look good, but also still keep that heritage from the past. And I think that this is probably one of the best looking heritage vehicles that's been produced. I think it's just got the right lines throughout and really has a very aggressive look to it. Even with the V6 engine, it still makes people's heads turn because first of all, they don't know what's underneath the hood, but I gotta say, just in general, it has a good look. Now, you do have the upgraded HID headlights up the front, regular fog lights at the bottom, and then you don't see them now, but you do have orange daytime running lights where the high beams are, and they look really good as you're driving along. Now, in terms of the rest of the vehicle, they did add the $325 paint strip to the side of the vehicle that says Challenger at the back. And really the only difference from the sort of the beginning years of this, especially something like the 2008, is the Challenger logo was in cursive writing. I kind of like that a little bit more. This is a little bit more masculine, but I really do like the way that it looked before. There are contact points on the door to unlock it. And we did notice that we were washing the car several times. And because the button on the top is to lock it, but you put your hand in but behind it in order to unlock it, for some reason shooting water at it would automatically unlock the car each time. Now, moving around to the back, again, Dodge has updated the rear end of this car to make it more in line with the heritage of the Dodge Challenger. They got rid of the old style lights that they were using before. They've gone with a more classic look. And I gotta say, it looks really good. I like the big oval shapes that go around with the Dodge logo at the back. You do have the camera built in to the spoiler here, and for the first time that we've seen is their new four-wheel drive branding, their little logo here that helps to distinguish the fact that this does use four-wheel drive over rear wheel only. Trunk is pretty good size. If you have some luggage, for example, you've got plenty of space to be able to put that in. And considering how big the car is, you know, the trunk size is actually pretty decent. There's quite a bit of a lip here. So if you are putting in something that is heavy, you're gonna wanna make sure that you're not gonna damage your trunk or the bodywork around it, because it is quite big. And one of the issues I know a lot of consumers have had with the trunk itself, if you take a look when I pop it, it doesn't really open up that much, and there's no grab handle here. So you're either pulling it from the bottom, or a lot of people end up pulling it up from the spoiler. And what will happen if you pull it from the spoiler over and over and over again, 100, 200, 300 times a year, is the spoiler gets loose. So I know that people have complained that that has an issue, but just maybe don't pull it up from the spoiler, you can pull it up from the bottom. And really finishing up the back, there are parking sensors along the bottom there, which really helps, because I gotta say that this is a big car. Considering there's not a whole lot of room on the inside of it, the size of it is quite large, and it does help just because of how big and massive really everything is when it comes to this car. It makes it a little bit easier for you to get in there and park if you're pulling it into a garage or into a parking spot. So much like what we find in 90s era BMWs, the center console here is driver oriented. The screen and the HVAC controls are pointing towards the driver just a little bit. So if you are sitting here in the passenger side, you can still obviously get to them. You do have this big piece of center here that at least has some leather around the side with this, like honeycomb style interior trim to it. So it does allow you to still get access to it, but really is a driver focused car. And I think that that's the whole point of the Dodge Challenger. Is really not for three, four people to be sitting in it. It really is just for one person to be driving this car. I want to spend a little bit of time talking about Uconnect 4.0. This is an updated version from what we used in the Jeep Grand Cherokee. And I have to say they've made significant improvements to the system here. First of all, it comes with navigation, as this trim has navigation and XM radio. So you can go into the radio here, you can listen to your music, you can go into the controls for your heated seats, ventilated seats, and steering wheel. And I find that the responsiveness is significantly improved over what we were using before. The fact that you do have navigation here certainly helps, but you do have Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. And the thing I like about it is when you're using Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, it doesn't take up the entire screen like some of the other products. It actually just fits in where, as we're in right now with the navigation system, it would fit just the screen there. So you can still have your home buttons and favorites at the bottom, along with your channel, temperature, and clock up at the top. So I really do like the improvements they've made to this. And a lot of the issues that we did express with the old version have been addressed with the new one. So I'm quite impressed with it here, and we've been enjoying it quite a bit. And they do have a lot going on in terms of performance stuff. I know this isn't the performance car, but there's a super track mode that allows you to go in here and you can actually set up pretty much everything. You can set up your engine and transmission, the paddle shifters, traction control, and steering. And you also have launch control, so you can activate launch control and get pretty much the most amount of power if you're doing something like a drag race and you want to be able to get first place when you're doing that. So they've got a lot of controls with that, which is pretty fun. You can close out of that and go into the performance pages as well. Again, something else that they've brought from the SRT models, and more specifically the Dodge Challenger Hellcat. They've brought in a lot of this stuff because it's just software. Who cares, right? Whether you're driving the V6 or that 6.4 liter supercharged V8, you can still be able to see all the fun things through the performance pages, such as your horsepower and torque in real time. It shows you which gear you're in as you're going. It'll show you your G vectoring as you're going around corners, and just a whole bunch of data that you really might not need on a daily basis. But if you really were to track this car, it is a lot of fun to be able to have that and see and get access to it in real time from there. You also have a lot of information in the gauge cluster. Same thing, you're able to show your vehicle information. So it'll show you if you're an all-wheel drive, battery voltage, and things like that. But I think where things get really dangerous is under the performance tab, where you can see your current G-forces and things like braking distance, your timers, reaction time for 0 to 60, 0 to 100, 0 to 160. But I think the one that's the most dangerous is the top speed. This really just eggs you on to be able to go as fast as possible and set a new record there. You also have your lap history and other things like that. So they really did bring a lot over from the SRT models into this. So you do have a much higher detail gauge cluster. You do have a lot of information going in with Uconnect 4.0. And the fact that everything is driver oriented really makes you realize that this car is designed for somebody, one person more, to be driving it, using it more as a performance car, even if you might think the V6 isn't powerful enough. But I think it's important for us to now go and take a look at how that V6 is on the road. Okay, so we're in the Super Track Pack. Activate launch control. You have to hold it for like a second just to make sure. And then it says to launch, press brake and quickly apply full throttle. And it says that it'll launch at 1,000 RPM. Oh, there you go. So yeah, you have to hold it. I don't know, it doesn't make much of a difference. I'm pretty sure that I could do the exact same thing if I just hold down the throttle, right? You don't even need to really do anything. So it basically what it does, you hold the brake, you give it full gas to activate the system so you know what you're doing, and it's not like you activated it by accident. And it'll basically just hold it until you let go of the brakes. I mean, it's not super amazing, but I don't know. I mean, if you're not able to launch the car yourself, then whatever. It's a fun little addition to it. And like I said, I mean, the performance stuff here is pretty decent. And overall, I mean, you know, like you could use the paddles and they're pretty fun. And I don't know. I mean, overall, again, this car isn't meant for somebody to be using nonstop performance on the track. You know, you're going to be doing that with the Hellcat or the Demon. If you just want a fun car to drive back and forth to work, it looks, you know, there's not a lot that you can get from the US of A that looks as good as this, because it really does have a unique look, and I still think that Chrysler did a very good job making this car look very good, considering it it really is one of the only heritage cars produced in North America that still looks, you know, very similar to what the original looked like without having to make it really ugly. I think it's a good looking car. So I think that's really the appeal of it, is people who want something that looks nice, goes, right? It's not slow, it's not quick, but it's definitely in between. And also, maybe, you know, you don't really care about the environment, because we've averaged not very well over the last 4 or 5 days with this car. It's not the least efficient that I've been using, but I think we've averaged now, it says average is 12.5 liters per 100 kilometers. So it's not the most efficient that we've driven. It's not the least efficient that we've driven, but it is something to definitely consider, that no matter which version of the Dodge Challenger that you're going to be going with, you are going to be spending a lot of time at the pump filling it up, because you are going to be using a lot of gas. Not because necessarily the engine is inefficient. I'm sure if you drove it efficiently, it would be fine. But the problem is, especially when the controls have a setting to tell you what your fastest speed was, it really just eggs you on to go fast. There's really no reason for you to go slow, because it just kind of makes you want to go fast. And when you go around a corner, you just gotta hammer it. There's really no other way to drive this car other than full throttle and to the max, because yeah, it kind of makes you into a bad guy. It makes you a bad boy. Driving this car, you're gonna be a bad boy. But overall, I mean, the seats are comfortable. The visibility is not too bad overall. And I think, just like some of the vehicles we've featured that are kind of unique, this one really stands out. Helps that the vehicle is bright orange. Chrysler calls it Go Mango. But I think it also helps too that a lot of people here are just really, maybe not concerned, but they're just surprised to be seeing a Dodge Challenger in the winter being driven around, because the all-wheel drive system is new. It's something that they haven't offered before. But it certainly makes sense, since the Challenger platform is shared with the Charger and the Chrysler 300, both of which offer all-wheel drive. So it kind of makes sense that they finally put it on a vehicle here. And yeah, it's only available on the V6. So that's certainly going to put off a lot of people who are looking to be buying this car. But I think that there is a market for people who want an all-wheel drive muscle car. Something like here in Quebec, people are, you know, they don't really necessarily want to buy a second car just for the winter that isn't going to be sloshing around because it's rear wheel drive. And, you know, they buy the Challenger and it's rear wheel, and, you know, they have fun with it during the summer, and then come November, they have to store it until April. But with the all-wheel drive, yeah, okay, you sacrifice the V8, but you do get all-wheel drive, which makes this a very compelling vehicle to drive year-round without having to put it in the garage. And we did have quite a bit of snow yesterday. We were able to drive it around, and, you know, if you want it to go sideways, this car will certainly do it. You give it the gas, even with that all-wheel drive system, and it'll get really fun. But if you want it to go straight and have complete control over what you're doing, it does that as well. I think it's a very sort of two-sided vehicle that you can do both things with it. And I think it certainly makes it very compelling to a lot of people up here in Quebec, in maybe places like Alberta, who need an all-wheel drive vehicle but don't want to sacrifice the design of it, because really, you know, this is a very unique looking car. You're really not going to find this anywhere else. And you know, like I said, having that all-wheel drive is quite fun.
Compared with our experience earlier with the Jeep Grand Cherokee, we enjoyed this Chrysler product significantly more. When it comes to the tech issues we had, they seem to have almost all been resolved with this latest version of Uconnect, and we actually found it to be really good. In fact, we were thoroughly impressed with the navigation system, which, when we used to actually navigate, provided the most realistic renders of exits off the highway. We tried to capture it on camera, where the design of the sign is about as accurate as you can get. Even the environment in the background, like the bridges or buildings, are insanely authentic to the real world. We also loved the sound from the 18-speaker Harman Kardon audio with the large green edge amp and subwoofer in the trunk. Some of the other things that we liked about this car was its overall design and keeping with the heritage of that first generation Dodge Challenger. The all-wheel drive system also worked exactly when we wanted it to, but allowed us to get a little sideways when desired. The performance data is also a great feature, considering it's all software and it trickles down from the SRT models, giving customers in this segment some extra toys to play with. We did have a few things with this car that we weren't completely sold on. The biggest issue was the active cruise control. The camera system on the front mistook the side running lights on trucks as brake lights, causing the system to activate the pre-collision warning. This happened several times during the same drive, as well as several times throughout our week. The passenger seat was also annoying for our daughter in the back. She needed extra room when the two of us were out for a drive, but the seat would always return to the furthest back position rather than the last notch it was set in before exiting. Now, I'm sure most coupes do this, and most people really aren't using the back seat anyway, but it is one of the very few issues we had during our week. Overall, this really was a fun car to have in both snowy and dry pavement conditions. We know it's not for everybody, and the appeal of this muscle car is relatively limited, but we applaud Chrysler for producing something unique and enjoyable to drive. Thanks for watching this episode of Test Drive Spotlight on the 2018 Dodge Challenger GT All-Wheel Drive. As always, your support helps make this show possible by liking and commenting on this video. Sharing on social media sites is a great way for us to grow, and subscribing helps us more than you can imagine as we climb towards our next milestone. Let us know in the comments below what you think about this muscle car or anything else you'd like to discuss. We always try to reply to all the comments left on our videos. Until next time, take care.